This is Carrie Ballinger. I'm a senior technologist with the Technology and Innovation Office here at Teradata. And this is going to be the first of a sequence of three TechBytes where we'll be talking about one of my favorite features in Teradata, the new Teradata Maps feature. So let's get started. As you probably know, Teradata is a parallel database. And one of the things that is very important in the Teradata database design is to ensure an even distribution of the data so that each parallel unit is working on about the same amount of data at the same time. One of the ways this happens is by means of a hash map. And the hash map comes into play when a row is inserted into a table in the database. The row's primary index is sent through a hashing algorithm. And one of the outputs of the hashing algorithm is what we call a hash bucket. That hash bucket goes through the hash map, and what comes out is the AMP that's going to own that row. So the hash map is the means of associating a particular row to an AMP in the configuration. When you have a Teradata system, and we're talking before you've expanded it, let's say your Teradata system today, you've got one hash map that essentially owns all your user tables. And we're calling it, in this example, TD underscore map 1. When you expand your system, you're going to get a second hash map that also will be covering your primary table data. But it includes more AMPs. It includes all the AMPs in the recently configured system. So now you've got two of these maps that exist at the same time for your primary data. You have the choice when you expand your system whether or not to move the individual tables into that new hash map or to leave them in the old hash map. And the difference is, and if you look at this slide, you can probably see it, TD map 1, your original hash map, covers the old AMPs, AMP 0 through 87 in this case. After the reconfig, you've got more AMPs, and TD map 2 will cover all of the AMPs, the old ones and the new ones. We call these types of maps contiguous maps because they cover a contiguous range of AMPs, always starting with AMP 0. This capability of leaving the tables, or this option of leaving the tables in the previous hash map after you've expanded a system, is an important way of reducing the downtime during system expansion. Here you have an example of those two hash maps in a little more detail. Hash map 1 is the hash map being used for the original TD map 1 contiguous map. And when you move a table from one hash map to another, the rows are actually placed on different AMPs because that second hash map, the one that you're moving the table to, uses a different number of AMPs. So the same primary index value will now be resulting in a hash map experience that'll point it to a different AMP. So you can expect your rows to reside on different AMPs when you move a table from one contiguous hash map to another. When you first move on 1610, before you've even expanded your system, you're going to see that you have several different maps available to you. TD map 1, the purple map, and we're showing you the span across AMPs in this graphic. That's your TD map 1 where your user tables are going to be if you chose not to move them during the reconfig. Then you're going to also see a dictionary map, TD data dictionary map. And that's a map that's going to hold all your DBC tables, including things like REST usage and DBQL tables. And then there's a third map which has internal purposes called TD global map. And they're all going to be contiguous maps that cover the same number of AMPs. When you expand the system, you're going to get an extra TD map 2 in there. So I want to go back to this point about not needing or not having to experience and wait for the move of all your tables across all the AMPs when you expand your hardware. The benefit here, of course, is reducing system downtime. And what happens is your administrator can then determine when to start moving those tables. We suggest that you have a goal of getting all your tables moved into the larger contiguous map because you'll then benefit from the wider parallelism. But you can do this over several weekends, over several months, at times that are convenient for you. So how do you move your tables then from TD map 1 into the new larger map, TD map 2? This is done by means of a new version of the alter table. And this alter table under the covers is actually an insert select, which is really great for moving tables in this context because you can read the data in the source table while the target table is being loaded. So the availability of your data increases using this technique. When it's complete, the alter table will drop the source table and do whatever it has to update the dictionary to make sure that we now know that this is the table in its new instance, and it's now on TD map 2. There is a mover stored procedure that we've created for you that we recommend you use, I recommend you use, because it makes things a little easier and it does some of the, a few extra things for you. You don't have to have all your privileges exactly the way you would have to have them if you did an alter table directly. So it's easier with the privileges. And the stored procedure, the mover stored procedure, collects summary statistics for you when the move is complete, so your statistics will be up to date. I just want to emphasize there's two major benefits here when you choose the option of moving the tables after the expansion is complete. And one is during the expansion, instead of taking hours and hours and hours or possibly days to get the reconfig utility to move the data for you into the new map, you now can bring the system up sometimes in a matter of minutes or hours, and the data is available to you for update, insert, delete, all kinds of processing that you might require. And the second advantage is when you're moving the tables yourself using the new version of the alter table, you're doing an insert select. So you have, as I mentioned earlier, the ability to read that data while it's being moved. So those are both important in terms of accessing the data. We mentioned the alter table, and we mentioned that there's a stored procedure that you can use to take care of the moving of tables for you. But really, think about that stored procedure as something that you might want to use occasionally as a one-off for special table moves. For most of the tables, you're going to want to use the Viewpoint Maps Manager portlet. This portlet makes the moving not only simple for you, but it gives you recommendations. Recommendations of how to group tables when you move them, which tables you should move together. When you start using the Maps Manager portlet, there is first an analyze job. And my suggestion is to scope your data. You've probably got a lot of tables you're thinking about moving, but think about a database at a time. And you can input that into the analysis job, what scope of tables that you are interested in moving. And the analysis job will make recommendations about which maps those tables are appropriate to move to. And in my next section, I'm going to talk about the sparse maps, but that's one of the reasons that I mentioned there may be more than one map that the analyze considers when it looks at your tables that you want to move. And it comes out with a list of recommended table moves, and then you can review that and make sure you want to move all those tables. And then you simply start the mover job, which is a second job within the Viewpoint portlet that does the actual moving. And one of the really interesting things about the mover job is that you can set up parallel jobs, tables that can be moved in parallel. And you do this by selecting a number of movers or workers that you want to be active for that move job. If you select three workers, then you're going to have three tables moved in parallel. And you can at any time increase or decrease the number of workers in that mover job. But this is all automated for you. What Viewpoint will do is each of the workers that you have selected, each of them will issue that same stored procedure, but for a different table. So you're maximizing the parallelism of the move process if you want to get it done and through the system faster. So let's just summarize the benefits of the MAPS feature. As it relates to the availability of the data, the downtime when you expand your configuration, when you add nodes, is being significantly reduced if you choose the option to postpone the move of the tables. Greater availability of the data will take place for your end users, and instead of waiting hours or days, it'll be a matter of minutes or maybe a few hours to be able to access that data again. Then the repositioning of the tables across the larger number of amps can take place at your convenience, at off hours, on weekends, whenever it's a helpful time to you to get that moved. And you can read the table data while it's being moved because the alter table is under the covers, an insert select statement which supports that. I will be talking in one of my future segments on MAPS a little bit about how the processing power can be taken advantage of by the optimizer even before you've started moving tables. So please join me in part 2 and part 3 to hear more about the MAPS feature.